Okay, so now we're going to move on to the data analysis section. So I'm going to give you a summary of all the documentation and literature you might need for help or to reference examining spectra to identify problems, any existing problems, and then trying to understand the root cause of these problems so we can go ahead and fix them. I'm going to present three problem cases. This is all using point source calibrated spectra. And the first is a point-like source in high galactic cirrus. Second is a point-like source with a pointing offset. And the third is a partially extended source. And then a quick summary of the problems that have been presented and corrected. And then a brief look at analysing corrected data for spectral line fitting and estimating noise, because these are two areas where there are some caveats. And then a quick look at mapping observations, because none of the problem cases are maps. Cubes. So I'm just showing the FTS flyer here because it is a handy, all the information you ever want to know about FTS in one A4 sheet. You have the calibration accuracy, images of spectra and interferogram, a cube. So this is really a very handy piece of information to have. And for, so in this presentation, we're just going to be for correcting the data, we're going to be looking at the point source calibrated spectra and not the cube. So here's a list of reference material. The two at the top in black are the SPIRE data reduction guide and the SPIRE handbook. And the data reduction guide will help you understand your data, and the SPIRE handbook will help you understand the instrument. And then there's a whole list of calibration papers that you can reference when they or read to understand more about calibration. And there's also a paper relating to SECT, the same extended correction tool, and a beam profile paper. So just a quick word to say that this analysis was performed in HIPE. However, as was shown in the previous presentation, the first presentation, the pipeline products, all the spectrometer data products are standard FITS files and can be accessed using your preferred analysis software. So within HIPE, there are a set of useful scripts which were designed to help with spectrometer analysis and further processing. And hopefully we designed them to be easily understood and easy to edit, in which case, and so they may be easily transferable to Python. Something like the noise estimate script. And even if there's scripts that involve line fitting, there's usually the Python equivalent. So just a few more details on a few of these. The spectrometer array footprint plot script compares with the photometer map. The spectrometer background subtraction script uses the off-axis detectors to subtract the extended emission, and this is one where the HPPP will be available soon. But do go ahead and ask the help desk if you think your observation looks like it has this particular problem. Also, there's the spectrometer pointing offset corrector script, POCT, which estimates and corrects the pointing offsets for point sources. However, it uses SECT, so it's got a high height dependency. So when you're going ahead and inspecting your data and you're looking for problems, go and have a look in the SPIRE DRG. It's very handy to help you diagnose issues, particularly in chapter 7, section 6.2. There's a section called Does My Spectrum Need Correcting? And I've taken the plot from there. So when you're looking at your data, you're going to be wanting to look to see if there's any jump between the bands, because if, say, one, you have a point source embedding the extended emission, you'll have a jump between the bands, as you see in the top row here. Or if two, you have a point source observation with a significant pointing offset, you'll see a jump between the bands, as you see in the middle row. And for three, a source with a semi-extended source, you'll get a jump between the bands. So all three issues can lead to a similar looking problem with your your spectrometer observation. And so it is important to separate the cause of the jump. Unfortunately, if you say had a combination of issues, it's not always possible to do so. But we're going to go through three cases where it is. So the first thing you'll do is you'll pop your observation ID into the HSA and you'll come up, have a look at the information results, and you'll click on the postcard. And then you can check the postcard to see if there's any obvious problems. So is there any problems with this observation? No. So we'll move on to one where there is. So here is an observation of AFGL 4106. And we can see straight away there's a jump between the bands. So there is a problem with the observation. We're going to go ahead and correct it. So the first thing to do is inspect the off-axis detectors. So that's the first and second ring, and the SSW is the third ring that you see in this plot on the left. Now this plot was created using the spectrometer array footprint useful script in HIPE, although the plot colours were edited. So the script looks, if there is no photometer map inputted, then the script looks for in the metadata where there are the photometer obs IDs recorded if there are any overlapping observations with the photometer. If you are inputting your own photometer map, you should use a comparison in the far infrared, one that isn't SPIRE. I mean, you should use one that is taken in the far infrared or the submillimeter, otherwise you're not going to be able to see appropriate emission to compare to the spectrometer. But you can use this sort of comparison to identify background, an extended background, foreground, or look for contamination by neighbouring sources. So here I'm just showing the full figure from Hopwood et al. And that's to show you a point-like source on the left that isn't in a background, and a semi-extended source on the right, compared with AFGL 4106. And you can see that AFGL 4106 looks point-like, but it is in this background. And if we look at an IRAS image, you can see it's actually sitting in galactic cirrus. So we'll go back to the other end. The problem is we know there's a jump between the band, but there's also there's a poor shape below 750 gigahertz and extra fringing above 850 gigahertz in SLW. So this is the problem here is an extended background has been calibrated as a point source, and which leads to this distortion of the continuum and the extra fringing. And that's because SLW has twice the beam of SSW, so more background gets in. And we can go ahead and correct the large scale noise in SLW. However, the background structured HPGP could be your solution. If it's not available, then you can go ahead and follow a similar method to one that's presented in the background subtraction script in HIPE. Now, what that does is it looks at the off-axis detectives, it plots them, smooths them and plots them, and it's an interactive script, so it then gives you the option of discarding any. Now, you can see the off-axis detector plotted for the SLW top left and SSW bottom left. And actually, apart from maybe SSWD2, which is the pink in the bottom left plot, it's not really outlying. When you see an outlying off-axis detector, which is what these plots are designed to show, they're really outlying and very obvious. So here you can just take the mean or both sets as they are, and then you simply subtract them from the centre detectors, and then this is the result you get on the right. So here on the right, the red is the data before correction, the green is the corrected data, and you can see that the jump between the bands is well corrected. However, and the shape below 750 gigahertz is also corrected. However, the fringing is still there. This method will not remove the fringing. So a note about this method, and that is there is actually some real flux in the outer ring of detectors. So if you have a look in Hopwood et al. 2015, it goes into it in much more detail. But for a point source, it was found that about 2% real flux in SLW first ring, and only about 1.1% in the SSW second ring. These are the rings that are used in the background subtraction script, the first ring of SSW is not used. And also, just let me go back a few slides. So this outer ring of detectors, the very outer ring, is in the vignetted region of the detector arrays. So they aren't used, as they do tend to have higher uncertainties. So you have to weigh up whether or not subtracting 2% of flux from SLW is worth the results. And I think for AFGL 406, the results are worthwhile because it's much easier to fit to the result and extract your line fluxes more accurately. So if we move on to case two, this is for source AFGL 2688. Again, it's a point-like source. This is a sparse mode observation. And we have a look at the postcard, and we can see there is a jump between the bands. And then if we check the metadata, there are two, there's the RADEC offset and the BSM offset, and these are pointing related. So I'll just go to the next slide so I'll give you the full definition. So these give information on known pointing. This is the offset between the commander position and the actual reconstructed pointing is the RADEC offset, and that includes the BSM offset. The BMS offset is necessary because before OD1011, the BSM was slightly offset at 1.72 arcseconds. That's including the RADEC offset. However, what isn't included is the absolute pointing error. That's still associated to the pointing. So to the best knowledge, our knowledge, the offset is 3.3 arcseconds. So that's what's causing the jump between the bands, this pointing offset. So we're going to use a useful script in HIPE to correct this, the popped script, the pointing offset corrector, which assesses the jump between the SLW and SSW bands to deduce pointing offset, and then it corrects using sect. This can only be used with point source calibrated spectrum and only for the center detectors, and only use POC to correct point light sources. And the SPIRE calibration is required because sect is used. So to briefly, the method, sect is used to create a grid of overlap ratios, and it does this by taking the input source model and making a grid of pointing offsets. And then the grid is used is the initial overlap and the initial overlap ratio to create to find the optimum offset to correct the spectra, and then that's used to correct the spectra with sect. And POC can take a while to run because using sect takes a while to create this grid. So these are the results. So what POC found in this case was an offset of a pointing offset of 6.08 arcseconds. And if we compare that to the known offset, which is derived using the relative method in Belchinoff et al., that was 6.21. So they agree within the errors. So it's a good result. And we can see the corrected spectra in the bottom in the right plot. And here, the jump is corrected. So if we move on to the third case, and this is a partially extended source. The Butterfly Nebula has a forward half maximum of 18 arcseconds. And we look at the postcard, we see there's a pronounced jump between the bands. And if we check the metadata, there isn't a significant pointing offset. So in this case, this jump is nearly wholly because of the semi-extended nature of the source. So to try and work out if you have a semi-extended source, you can compare your point source calibrated and extended calibrated spectra that are in your level two folder. So if we have a look at this figure, on the left we have a point light source calibrated and extended source at the top, and a point light source calibrated with the set point source calibration at the bottom, and you can see which is the appropriate calibration in this case. So there's a nice, the bottom plot shows a nice smooth spectra that agrees very well between the bands. And on the very far right side of this diagram, we have an extended source, the top right. When you calibrate that with an extended calibration, it's very nice and agrees between the bands and looks very smooth. Whereas in the bottom, there's distortion to the continuum and a huge step if you calibrate it with the point source calibration. And in the middle, we have the semi-extended cases where neither calibration is working well. And that's what we have for NGC 6302. Neither calibration scheme is working well, so it leads to this poor spectral shape. And if we go back to that array footprint plot that I showed a few slides ago, NGC 6302 was the one plotted on the right, and we can see this that it's in the spectrometer map, we can see it's a slight oval. So now we can go ahead and correct the sect. So just very briefly, you can read all about the algorithm in Wirtel 2013 and also in the DRG in the handbook. But the algorithm is based on the forward coupling efficiency to the source distribution. So it is really important to have a good knowledge of the source distribution to get a good result. Now here we're just using the default sect settings with a basic elliptic and Gaussian, a full width half maximum of 18 arc seconds, and we're making it a little oval, and we're not putting in any offset. We're also setting optimized diameter to equal true. However, sect assumes that the correction efficiency, which is again discussed in Wirtel, is assumed to be 1, which may not be true, so this can lead to extra error on the result. So here we have the results. So sect estimates that the diameter of the source to be 18.5 arc seconds, which agrees quite well with the known size of the source of 18 arc seconds. And the jump is corrected quite well. Now you can see that there's a good agreement between the brown and the green spectra. However, there is room for improvement, and that's probably because we need better knowledge of the source model, which isn't just a simple oval. It's more complicated than that. But it's a much better result than we had before, and you'll get much more reliable line plots. So just to summarise, we looked at a source in high-extended background, for which there'll be HPDPs soon. And you can contact the help desk to see if there's one already available. But you must remember that subtracting off-axis detectors does subtract some real signal, and you need to weigh up the benefits of this compared to the results, compared to the loss, sorry. There's also, we looked at unknown pointing offsets using POCT to estimate the pointing offset. But it's not easy to use this method for anything other than a point source unless you have really good knowledge of the source distribution. And also for the semi-extended source using sect, the sect method is the correct one to use. You could try and code it up outside of HIPE, but it might be a little bit tough. Again, a good knowledge of the source distribution is needed, and E2C may not be one, so there can be extra errors associated to this method. So now onto just a quick note on spectral line fitting. So now your data has been corrected, it's ready for analysis, and one thing you might want to do is measure the line blocks. So I've brought back this, there's a few things you need to remember. So I brought back this plot that was shown in one of the other presentations of the line asymmetry, because the line is a good sync shape, but it's not perfect. And we have this 2%, 2.6% shortfall if you put a sync. So that's something to remember when you're line fitting. Also, you could use aphidizing to help find faint lines. Here is an aphidized spectrum. It's the black line over the standard data, which is the green. And for each of the known lines that is shown here, you can see there's a bump in the aphidized spectrum, but it's not always obvious in the standard data. However, if you are fitting and measuring your line flux, you should do that in the standard data and use sync functions. Also on line fitting, you should fit to the lines and the continuum simultaneously to achieve the best fit. This is the approach taken in the spectral, in the useful script, spectrometer line fitting useful script. It's also a good method to use outside of HIPE. These are the plots you get when using the line fitting script. We see the fitted model is the red, and the residual is the green, and the blue is the input spectrum. And now, and also, you might want to estimate the spectral noise. Now, there is a useful script in HIPE to do this, and it uses a straightforward method which you could easily recreate outside of HIPE. But things to remember are you must remove the lines for taking the noise. If you have significant features, because of the sync wings that cause ringing across the whole frequency range, that is the dominant noise source for spectrally strong features. If you don't remove them, you won't get the right result. I'm going to also that it, once you've corrected a semi-extended source using sect, the noise will increase because again, because this means your data has been corrected for loss flux and it's been multiplied by factors, so the data, the brightness has increased. And the next two slides illustrate these points for the problem case 3, NGC 6032. So if you take data straight from the archive and go to measure the noise directly, the method here is taking the standard deviation of the baseline subtracted data after it's been divided into frequency bins. And so you'll get the green. And you can see those peaks, each peak is corresponding to a very strong spectral feature. And then after correcting with sect, the noise goes up. So you now have the blue line. So lines are dominating the noise here. So if we go back and we fit and remove just the strong features, so you get this orange residual in the bottom left plot. This is the noise estimate using the same method. And again, there's still noise, there's still lines. Here are the 13 CO lines, for instance. So we need to go back and try and subtract all of the faint, all of the lines that are significant, and then you get the red result, which is a lot smoother. However, it's still above the H spot, which is the predicted noise used when the observation was proposed, and that's because of sect, the sect correction. So just a quick note, move on to mapping now. This is taken from Van's presentation, just to reiterate the fact that you there are two different samplings. There's intermediate sampling maps and mapping observations and fully sampled mapping observations. And they give you slightly different looking cubes just because of the coverage. And here are the coverage cubes. This is a slice to the coverage cube for naive cubes. And you can see that for a naive cube, this is where you're getting holes in naive cubes. You can have holes in the map because there are two dead detectors in SSW. And this led to holes that can be even at the center of the map. And that's why using the convolution to make the CP cube is a good idea if you have holes in your map. So that's probably the one you're going to want to use if they're at the center. And here's an example of a naive cube, a slice of a naive cube. Actually, this is an integrated map over 1250 to 1270 gigahertz. This is a low resolution, fully sampled special calibration raster that was taken on OD261 NGC 7023. This is the SSW cube. And on the left, we have the naive projection, which is the mean of all the spectra within a pixel, or all the spectra that fall within the pixel are just averaged together. And here we have the on the right, we have the CP cube, the convolution projection cube, which is the Gaussian weighted mean of all the spectra falling within the convolution kernel. And I think the width of the kernel is twice the forward half maximum. So just to note that the CP cube is smoother, it has a slightly lower noise, particularly for SLW under 600 gigahertz. It's convolved, the convolution is spatial, so the smoothing is per frequency slice, so there's no difference in the line, in the resulting line shape for a CP cube. As we said, the naive cubes can suffer holes in the map due to the coverage, whereas the coverage, obviously because of the convolution, the coverage there's no holes for a CV cube. But this can lead to partial spectra at the edge of the cube. You might find right at the edge, there wasn't enough, the coverage has to be above a certain threshold for the data to be included. But the convolution is on per frequency slice, there can be partial spectra with gaps in frequency where there wasn't enough coverage because the beam size is changing per slice. However, these two cubes do have the same WCS. So when it comes to analysing cubes, there are, you obviously might have your own favourite method outside of HIPE, but for cubes, they can be a little bit tricky to get into. So a good place to start is in HIPE. It has a number of tools and scripts that are geared purely for Herschel cube analysis. And this I've just put up here as a final plot is the integrated line flux plot from the spectrometer cube fitting script, which will fit. There's a global fit to every spectra in the cube, and you end up with a number of line flux in a cube. And you can adjust that. And that's described in section 7.12, how to edit that script to get different outputs, and how to get this, it gives you this nice plot. So it's not a bad place to be for cubes. Okay, so we haven't covered all of the useful scripts available in HIPE or all of the analysis you can do with spectrometer data. So if you have any questions on any of these scripts or any spectrometer analysis or data problems, do send them to the help desk with a question and answer session. And thank you very much for attending.